The electromechanical relay. These are fascinating little devices, and they're used in all kinds of electronic and electrical systems. But where do they come from, and what do they do? The first telegraph relays were invented around the same time by American physicist Joseph Henry and the English inventor Edward Davy in the 1830s. But it would take another century before people realized that relays could be used as logic elements, and the German computing pioneer Konrad Zuse built his machines in the late 1930s. A relay is a box with an electromagnet inside, and a metallic conductive bar called an armature. When the electromagnet is energized, the metal armature is attracted towards a terminal, which allows a circuit to be completed or closed by the electromagnet. When the electromagnet turns off again, the armature returns to its original position and the circuit is broken or opened. Building upon this design, the next step is to add a second terminal, creating a double-throw relay. This terminal is the normally closed terminal because it forms a closed circuit when the relay is in its de-energized or normal state. The other terminal is the normally open terminal because any circuit connected to it will be open when the relay is in its normal state. The double-throw relay allows you to switch between two circuits, like this. When the electromagnet is disconnected, the relay is in its normal state and the bulb on the left is lit up. When the electromagnet is connected, the armature moves to the normally open terminal and the bulb on the right lights up. You can also add more poles to a relay. This is a double-pole, double-throw, or DPDT relay. The poles refer to the separate armatures, allowing you to switch multiple circuits simultaneously. There are two normally closed terminals and two normally open terminals, each of which has its own independent armature. In this example, the bulbs on the top left and bottom right are turned on in the normal state. When the relay is energized, the bulbs will switch. Relays come in a vast array of different configurations of throws and pulls, but the DPDT is very common and widely available, so that's what I'm going to use for my computer project. These are the DPDT relays that I'm going to use for my project. They're cheap and small and easy to use. These two pins on the outside connect to the coil and allow the relay to be turned on and off. The middle pins connect to the armature on each of the relay's two poles. These inside pins are the normally closed terminals for each pole, and the outside pins are the normally open terminals. These relays also have the right pin spacing to make them easy to use in a breadboard. That makes prototyping circuits especially simple. To build a computer, I need to build logic gates, which are machines that implement logical functions. Take a look at this sentence. The word AND is a logical function. It tells us that for the conclusion to be true, both of these conditions need to be true. If either or both of them are false, then there is no need to carry an umbrella. We can make a mathematical model of this idea using a tool called a truth table. This table shows every possible permutation of the two conditions and the conclusion about whether we should carry an umbrella. The AND function tells us that we should only carry an umbrella if it is raining and we're going outside. We can generalize this idea by replacing the specific conditions with the letters A and B, and the word umbrella with the expression A and B. Then we can replace the yeses and nos with ones and zeros, yielding the Boolean AND function. The truth table makes it clear that the AND function only outputs a 1 when both inputs are 1. Now, abstractions are great, but to actually implement this function as a logic gate, we need two relays wired together like this. The number 1 on the left indicates a constant voltage that's permanently wired to the armature on the A relay. With both relays turned off, there's no completed circuit, and the A and B output on the right is turned off. If we turn the B relay on, current can still not flow to the output even though the armature is connected to it because there's still no connection to the voltage source. If we turn A on and leave B off, current can reach the B relay, but there's nothing connected to its normally closed terminal, so the A and B output is still turned off. It's only if we turn on both relays that the circuit is completed, and we've successfully built an AND gate. Now you might be wondering how many logic gates there are. We might try to write every possible truth table for two inputs and one output. We can see that the A and B input columns will never change, since they just show every possible permutation of input states. The only thing that would actually change is the output column. There are 16 ways to arrange a group of four binary numbers, so that means there should be 16 possible logic gates, and here they are. Now, not all of these are actually useful. For example, if we take a look at this one, we can see that no matter what the inputs are, the output is always 1. This gate would be the equivalent of just wiring something directly to a positive voltage rail. It doesn't actually give us any useful information. Some other gates look like they might potentially be useful, but upon closer inspection, it turns out that they really aren't. The output in this gate just copies whatever is on the A input. The B input doesn't matter. This is an example of a non-binary function. It's non-binary because it doesn't have two inputs, it only has one. If you were to actually build this gate in the real world, it wouldn't matter whether or not you even connected the B input, you'd get the same result either way. So if we eliminate the useless gates, and we eliminate all the non-binary gates, that leaves us with just a few that are potentially interesting. The first is the AND gate, which we've already seen. The next is the OR gate. This function always outputs a 1 except when both inputs are 0. Immediately to the left is the exclusive OR or XOR gate. It outputs 1 when either but not both of its inputs are 1. Another way of thinking about XOR is that it outputs a true result whenever its inputs are opposites, so it actually forms an inequality operator. Now each of these three gates also has an inverse on the bottom row. The first is the NOT AND or NAND gate. This one always outputs 1 except when both inputs are 1. It's the exact opposite of the AND gate. The next one is the NOT OR or NOR gate. This one outputs 1 when its inputs are both 0. It's the exact opposite of the OR gate. The final one is the exclusive NOR or XNOR gate. It outputs 1 when both of its inputs are identical. It's the exact opposite of XOR, and so it also makes an equality operator. Now, after all of that, there are still four gates left, but it turns out they're not really useful, aside from theoretical interest. They are valid logical functions, but they don't really come up in digital circuit design, because everything that we need to do can be done with the six basic gates demonstrated here. The one I'm interested in right now, though, is the XOR gate, so let's see how to build that one. Here I've actually got two relays facing each other, so the armature terminals are facing away from one another. I'm going to use the armature of one relay as the gate's output. If we turn on the B relay, current can flow from the normally closed terminal on A to the normally open terminal on B, creating a closed circuit, so the output is turned on. If we turn A on and leave B off, current can flow through the opposite terminals, and the output remains turned on. And if we turn both relays on, current can no longer flow, so the output is turned off. I've decided to experiment with the AND and XOR gates for my first actual design. This design uses both poles of two relays to create the AND and XOR gates simultaneously. The board has power and ground connections which tie into copper planes on the top and bottom of the board. The A input is connected to the coil on the top relay, and the B input is connected to the coil on the bottom relay. The top pair of poles is used to create the AND gate by connecting the normally open terminal of A to the armature of B, and then connecting the normally open terminal of B to the AND output. The bottom two poles are used to make the XOR gate by connecting the normally open terminal on A to the normally closed on B via a trace on the top of the board, and vice versa with a trace on the bottom of the board. The armature is then connected to the XOR output. Finally, I also used a spare normally closed terminal on the top relay to create an inverter, which gives the opposite of the A input via the NOT A output. Here's what the PCB looks like after I got it back from the fabricator. Now it just takes a little bit of assembly and some soldering. After I was done putting the board together, I attached some ribbon cable to some switches so I could test the individual logic gates, and they worked perfectly. Now, there is a specific reason why I chose the AND and XOR gates for my first experiment, but I'll get into that in the next video. For now, thanks for watching.